Well, good morning, family of Grace. My name's Ethan. I'm the tech coordinator here at Grace Central Coast. We're a multi-campus gospel-centered church located on the central coast of California, and we're all about helping people find and follow Jesus. If this is your first time worshiping here with us, go ahead and click the I'm New button down there in the chat. And if you're watching on YouTube, you can keep watching on YouTube, but just head over to gracecentralcoast.org and engage in that chat. We would love to know that you are here worshiping with us. And you can also email chris@gracecentralcoast.org. We'd love to know that you're here and pray for you. As you can see, today is Communion Sunday. So right now or anytime during the service, go grab something to eat and something to drink. We'll just be communing together today. But with that, let's start off our time of worship by reading from Psalm 145. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. And sing together.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Have you done for me? Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nation with truth. Justice shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place. For me.
This morning, let's just sing about how worthy he is.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. that you've done for me.
God, we just thank you for who you are and what you've done. We thank you that you paid it all for us on the cross, and that you have a gentle and lowly heart, and that you look upon us and you just shower us with mercy that we don't deserve. So I just pray that we're just reminded of these truths, through the word and just through the rest of the songs and just communion today. And I raise this up in your son's name. Amen.
Good morning, Family of Grace. My name is Bethany Cotting. I'm the Outreach Director here. And right now we're going to be jumping into our time of giving back. If you are new to Grace, we're not asking you to give. We're just really excited that you're here. But if you do call Grace Central Coast your home, there are just three ways that you can give. You can give online on the Church Center app or by mail. And for giving back, today we are highlighting our youth ministry, where the gospel of Jesus Christ is alive and well with our youth. This past week, we had an event where we said goodbye to 13 graduating seniors and moved 15 eighth graders into the high school ministry. This was a great time of prayer and worship, and where we really see God is working in these students' lives. Heading into the summer, our youth ministry has set goals that involve outreach, relationship building, and welcoming new students at all the campuses, and we're just really excited for that. We've got a big calendar full of events and worship opportunities, including pool parties, beach nights, book studies, and even a week at Hume Lake Christian Camp. We're super stoked about it. Our SLO campus has had a long history of fruitful youth ministry, and over this next year, we are making an effort to replicate that model at our North County and Five Cities campuses. We're kickstarting a new middle school program, and we hired Graham Farrell as the new North County Youth Coordinator, and we're super excited about it, everything that's going to happen. So if you'll bow your heads with me, I'll be leading us in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much that we can come before you and worship you and just praise you for all that you're doing here at Grace Central Coast and on the Central Coast, Lord. I thank you for our youth ministry, for the staff and leaders and the students, Lord. I pray that you work in all of their hearts, Lord, that it will be a time of growth and learning more about you, and that you'll be with the leaders as they pour into these students' lives and be with the students as they grow in their relationship with you, Lord, as they find and follow you. I ask all these things in your name. Amen. And now, if you'll open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 11, I'll be reading from verses 20 and 30. Matthew 11, 20 through 30. Then he began to denounce the cities where most of his mighty works had been done, because they did not repent. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? You will be brought down to Hades. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. But I tell you that it will be more tolerable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom than for you. At that time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who are labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Bethany. Hey, everyone. So good to have you worshiping online with us. Thank you so much for being here today. And boy, we're still just processing and celebrating all that happened at our massive Celebrate Grace event out at the Madonna Meadow last weekend. It was quite a day. And if you didn't make it, we sure missed you. We thought about you. And we're aware that the live stream did not quite work as well as we had hoped. And yet, hopefully, you were able to catch the spirit of the event and the message at the event and really celebrate with us the fact that God provided for us our $9.4 million Next Vision goal. He supplied over and above that amount through your faithful giving, the giving of the family of Grace Central Coast. Thank you so much for your part in all that's happening in the life of our church And again, if you didn't make it last weekend, we missed you. Well, today we kick off a brand new summer series that we're calling The Heart of Jesus. Here's the reality. In our church, we talk a lot about the work of Jesus. We talk a lot about the teaching of Jesus, but we don't talk as much about the person of Jesus. We talk a bunch about what Jesus said and did and does, but we don't talk enough about who Jesus is and what Jesus is like. But behind the teaching and the work of Jesus is a person, a real person, with whom you and I can have a real relationship. And Jesus wants us to know him and relate with him. So this summer, we want to go where we don't normally go. We're going to take a look at the heart of Jesus, what the heart of Jesus is like, and for what the heart of Jesus beat and eventually bled. Now, a couple of notes about our series. We are unapologetically springboarding off the first half of this excellent little book entitled Gentle and Lowly. It's kind of created a buzz this past year, and you may have even heard about it. Several of our staff have read it, and they've raved about it. I read it with a group of men earlier this year, and I too loved it. And now we want to invite you to grab this book and read along with us this summer, Gentle and Lowly. I'm kicking things off today, but this series will be team taught by some of our other gifted teaching pastors, and I know that you enjoy them, and this is an awesome opportunity for them. It's an opportunity where they'll grow in their teaching, and I know that we as a church family are always blessed by the rotation. Each week, we're going to look at a different passage in the Bible, which gives us, each one will give us a window and an insight into who Jesus is and what Jesus is like. When I was growing up, my mom collected these different shaped glass prisms, and she hung these prisms that she collected in one of our kitchen windows so that when the sunlight shone through that window in the morning and caught those prisms, it would scatter these light shapes all across our kitchen. And I loved those prisms as a kid, and they're a fond memory for me. In fact, I can picture them in my mind's eye in that window even today. Each passage that we're going to look at this summer, it's really like one of those prisms. And as we look at the heart of Jesus through these prisms, they're going to scatter for us the light of Jesus in all its dazzling beauty. Each scriptural prism will enable us to see something different about the person of Jesus and his heart. Today, we're going to kick things off with another look at Matthew 11, 28 through 30. And you may remember that we looked at this passage not too long ago on Easter Sunday. And on that day, we focused on the rest that Jesus offers. But today, we're going to take another look at this passage. And this time, we're going to see the heart of Jesus who offers us this rest and the striking, surprising way that Jesus describes himself. So I want to invite you, please open a Bible with me to Matthew chapter 11. Grab that outline on your worship folder. In your worship folder, you can do that online by just clicking that notes tab just below the chat window at our website at gracecentralcoast.org. We want to encourage you to take some notes today. And taking some notes will help you follow along. I always like to say that taking notes will make this message sticky in your mind and heart. So, Jesus, turns out, talked about the human heart, our hearts, quite a bit throughout his ministry and throughout the Gospels. For example, Jesus said this, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Jesus said, "For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks." But it was Charles Spurgeon who first pointed out that only one time did Jesus speak of his own heart. And it's right here in Matthew chapter 11. This is the only time Jesus talks about his own heart. Take a look at the text with me, Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. "Come to me," says Jesus, "all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. And you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I think that's pretty fascinating, the fact that this is the only time when Jesus talks about his own heart. I think this is worth our contemplation. So today, to help us understand Jesus' words in Matthew chapter 11, let's ask and let's answer five questions together. And the first question is this: what is the heart? When we, you and I, speak of the heart, we usually mean one of two things. We either mean the physical organ on the left side of our chest that keeps us alive by pumping blood every minute of every day to our body's extremities. Or, when we speak of the heart, we mean the seat and the source of our emotions and feelings. As in Disney's constant battle cry, just follow your heart. Which really means just do what you feel. And by the way, that's usually not such a good idea at all, but that's a message for another day. When the Bible speaks of the heart, it doesn't mean either of these two. When the Bible speaks of the heart, it means something so much more. When the Bible speaks of the heart, it's not talking about a part of who we are, but rather, it's talking about the center of who we are. Our heart, then, when the Bible speaks of the heart, our heart is what defines us. Our heart is what directs us. The heart drives all that we do. Our heart is who we really are. And this is exactly why Proverbs 4:23 encourages us: keep your heart with all diligence, for from it flow the springs of life. From our hearts come our life. And this biblical understanding of the heart is crucial for understanding what Jesus is telling us in Matthew chapter 11. Jesus is speaking of his heart, the center of who he is, what defines him, what directs him. Jesus is talking about who he is at the very core of his being. So let's ask and answer our second question. What is the heart of Jesus like? Jesus, in the one and only place he describes his own heart, uses just two words to do it. And I think that they are striking, surprising, and unexpected words. Take a look at the text again. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Here it is. For I am gentle and lowly in heart. Notice, Jesus does not say, I'm harsh and critical in heart. Jesus does not say, I'm exacting and demanding in heart. Jesus doesn't even say, I'm exalted and holy in heart. Or, I'm happy and gracious in heart. Jesus could have said so many different things to describe his heart. But Jesus says only these two. I am gentle and lowly in heart. And so these two words are surprising. Let's ponder them together. The heart of Jesus is gentle. The Greek word for gentle shows up three other times in the New Testament. In Matthew chapter 5:5, this Greek word is translated meek. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. The second time this word shows up is in Matthew 21, verse 5, describing Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem just before his crucifixion. It's a quote from Zechariah 9:9. And here, the word is translated humble. Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble, there's the word, and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. The third instance of this word beyond Matthew chapter 11 is in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 4, where Peter is encouraging wives to focus not only on their outward beauty, but also to cultivate their inward beauty. And here the word is translated again as gentle. But let your adorning be of the hidden person of the heart, with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. So meek, humble, and gentle. When Jesus describes his own heart, this is the first word that he chooses. This is who Jesus is. This is what defines him and directs him. If you were to cut Jesus, this was what Jesus would bleed. Gentleness. Jesus is not easily frustrated. Jesus doesn't have a short fuse. Jesus is not mean or unpredictable or impatient. Jesus doesn't fly off the handle. He isn't scary or intimidating or threatening or imposing. But he's also not weak or spineless. The heart of Jesus, first and foremost, is gentle. Gentle is who Jesus is. And the second surprising word, the heart of Jesus is lowly. Now, what does this mean? This word, too, is sometimes translated humble. For example, it's used in James 4, 6. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Usually when this word is used in the Bible, it's not referring to the virtue of humility, but rather to the poor, the underprivileged, the unimpressive, the marginalized, or those brought low by the rough and tumble circumstances of life. And so Paul says in Romans 12, verse 16, do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. So what does Jesus mean when he says that he's lowly in heart? What is Jesus saying? Dane Ortlund, in Gentle and Lowly, this book, explains it this way. The point in saying that Jesus is lowly is that he is accessible. For all his resplendent glory and dazzling holiness, his supreme uniqueness and otherness, no one in human history has ever been more approachable than Jesus Christ. I so love that. What does it mean that Jesus is lowly? It means that no one is more welcoming and accepting than Jesus. No one. This is what it means when Jesus says, I'm lowly in heart. This is what Jesus says about himself, about his very own heart. This is not part of who he is, but the very center of who he is, what defines him and directs him. Jesus is gentle and lowly in heart. So, a question for you and I. Is this how you think about and relate to Jesus? When you relate with Jesus, if you relate to Jesus, do you think about Jesus in these terms? As gentle and lowly in heart. Is this how you would describe Jesus? This is how Jesus describes himself. Is this how you would describe Jesus? Are these the first words that you would use to describe Jesus? This is what Jesus would want us to say and think about him, because this is what Jesus says about himself, that he's gentle and lowly in heart. But let's ask another important question for us, a third question today. Who is the heart of Jesus for? In other words, is the gentle and lowly heart of Jesus for everyone? Is this who Jesus is to everyone, universally, all the time, without distinction? The answer is no. The larger context of Matthew chapter 11, in fact, makes it clear that the gentle and lowly heart of Jesus is not for everyone. Everyone does not experience Jesus like this. So look back at where our scripture reading began today, back up at verse 20. Look what it says. It says, then Jesus began to denounce the cities where most of his mighty works had been done because they did not repent. Jesus said, woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? No, you will be brought down to Hades. You see, that's not gentle and lowly. Jesus is denouncing these cities and their inhabitants. Jesus is pronouncing the warning of a sure and coming judgment upon these cities. Why? Because these cities were places where Jesus did most of his miracles. But the people in these cities refused to receive Jesus. They refused to acknowledge who Jesus is. They refused to repent before Jesus. And then Jesus says this in verse 25. Take a look. At that time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you've hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. What is Jesus saying here? Those who think they're wise and understanding, in other words, the hotshots of this world, the put together and the accomplished of this world, they don't. They won't. They can't see who Jesus is and their own need to repent. Their pride blinds them to Jesus. Jesus is concealed from them. They don't feel their need. But by contrast, it's the Father's gracious will to reveal the truth about who Jesus is to little children. In other words, to those who are humble and needy, and those who come to Jesus with their need, with a simple faith. And all of this is the run-up to Jesus' invitation in verse 28. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. So who is the heart of Jesus for? Who are these little children? Who is Jesus addressing? Do you see it? It's right there. The heart of Jesus is for those who labor. This word is often translated weary. And the reality is, you know it and I know it, life is a lot of work and the work never seems to stop. The brokenness of this world is real and it's exhausting. It's said multiple times a week in our house, I'm so tired. Those who know that, those who feel that, those who are willing to see their need and admit it, the gentle and lowly heart of Jesus is for you. Come to me, says Jesus, all who labor and are heavy laden. This word heavy laden means weighed down. In other words, the heart of Jesus is for those who are burdened. Those who feel the burden of this broken and sin-scarred world. Those who feel the burden of their own sin. The burden of others' sin upon them. The burden of the world's sin. The gentle and lowly heart of Jesus is for you. Those who are burdened. Jesus came not for those who are well, but for those who are sick and know it. You and I, it's just natural. I think it's just natural among human beings. We spend most of our lives, so much energy in our lives, trying to eliminate our needs, trying to overcome our needs, or if we can't do that, trying to hide our needs. We paper over our needs. We're doing it constantly. We're striving to become worldly wise and understanding, successful and self-sufficient. But in all that striving, we're actually disqualifying ourselves. Turns out we're disqualifying ourselves from receiving the heart of Jesus. The more physically successful and accomplished and wealthy we become, the danger is the more blind to our spiritual need we also become. But do you see? It's our need. It's the awareness of that need. It's exhaustion and the burden of it that actually qualify us to receive the gentle and lowly heart of Jesus. Do you hear how radical the words and invitation of Jesus are? So countercultural, so counterintuitive, so challenging. So let's ask the next question. How do we experience the heart of Jesus? If Jesus is gentle and more accessible and more approachable and more welcoming than any person in history ever was, if he's more approachable than we could ever imagine or fathom, if his heart is for those who feel, those who know their need, then how do we get his heart? How do we experience his heart? Well, the answer is clear in the text. Jesus tells us, come to me. I mean, it's that simple. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. No matter what you've done in your past or how often you've done it, Jesus says, come. No matter how many times you've blown it this week, come. No matter how many times you've come to Jesus before but then left Jesus again, Jesus says, just come, because we never stop coming. And that's all that Jesus asks. Come to me. His arms and his heart are wide open. This really is the one, the only prerequisite to receive and experience the gentle and lowly heart of Jesus. Will you come? What is keeping you from coming? Coming to him today for the very first time, coming back to him today. We come every day. What is keeping you? Will you come? Well, there's one more question that I asked personally as I sat in this text, and really as I read this book, Gentle and Lowly. And so it's a question I want to ask you today. The fifth question is this one. Are we learning from the heart of Jesus? Jesus invites us to take his yoke. That's an agricultural picture. An ancient agricultural picture. It's still happening in some places in the world today. But in order to plow a field, two oxen or cows or livestock would be yoked together in a wooden yoke. They'd be paired together. So Jesus invites us to pair ourselves with him, to connect ourselves with him, to take his yoke upon us so that we might learn from him, to become like him as we walk with him and plow through life next to Jesus. And here's the reality. Here's the truth. Experiencing the heart of Jesus is to shape our hearts to become like his heart. The heart of Jesus is gentle and lowly toward me. And so the question is, what about my heart? What about your heart? Is it gentle and lowly toward others? Am I humble and approachable? Or am I distant and disengaged? Am I threatening? Am I unwelcoming? Are these two words, gentle and lowly, are these words that others around me would use to describe my heart? Oof. The reality is, if I'm honest, I don't think so. I don't know about you, but I've got so much learning from Jesus yet to do. And so we come to this table together today. And this table tells us about the gracious work of Jesus, his body broken for us, his blood shed for the forgiveness of our sins. But We've been reminded today that the work of Jesus flows from the gentle and lowly heart of Jesus. Behind the great and gracious work of Jesus is a real and a living, a resurrected person. And so as we come to this table today, we come to him. I really want you to think about that as we come today. We don't just come to a table, we come to Jesus. We come to a person, a living person. And so will you come again? I want to give you just a couple of minutes of silence. Ethan's going to come and begin to play, and then we're going to sing. But before we sing, I just want to give you a couple minutes of silence so that you can come and talk to and relate with Jesus. This is a time for you to confess your sins to him, but also to bring your labor, your exhaustion, your burdens, all your needs, all your neediness. This is an opportunity for us to bring that to him. Remember, he invites us to come. This is exactly what he wants. This is what he calls us. This is how he calls us to come. He invites us. Because remember, he's gentle and lowly in heart. And so take a couple minutes now and come, and Ethan, and help us reflect.
God's heart and the center of his heart, that he's gentle and lowly towards us, and that we praise him for who he is, not just what he's done, but just his heart for us.
Compares to this, what a beautiful name it is, the name.
gentle and lowly. And because of it, that gentle and lowliness poured out in your actions and you died on the cross for us. But you just didn't stay in the grave. You rose again 3 days later. So we just thank you and we praise you for that.
Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again.
Thank you so much, Ethan. Well, brothers and sisters, those who know their need, those who feel their need today, I want to invite you now to come to this table. I want to encourage you now to grab a piece of bread, whatever you might have there in the house, whatever you might have in front of you. And I say to you today that because Jesus is gentle and lowly in heart, this is his body, which is given for you. Take and eat in remembrance of him. Our gentle and lowly Savior, his blood was shed for the forgiveness of our sins, and so take a cup, whatever you have there in front of you, and drink with me. This is Christ's blood, which is shed for us. Let's take in remembrance of him. Let's pray together and give thanks this morning. Lord, we just thank you so much. Help us believe that this is who you are. We're challenged in that. We don't always believe this is who you are. This is not how we relate to you. This is not how we think about you as gentle and lowly in heart. But this table reminds us. This table reassures us that that is who you are. This is your heart towards us. You're gentle and lowly. And Lord, would you make us these kind of people? Would you conform our hearts? Would you change our hearts to be more like yours? You're not finished with us yet. And we really do say, oof, this is not who we are most of the time. We've got so much more to learn from you. What would you teach us as we take that yoke upon us, as we keep coming to you? We want to do that. We want to be those who just constantly come. And so would you change us and make our hearts more like you? Help us to be gentle and lowly to those around us, those in the community, those who are hostile to you out in the world. We want to be this kind of people, and we're so often not. So we just confess that to you today, and we ask for you to change us. We thank you that you gave yourself for us, and that this table is really the expression of who you are. Your work flows from your person. You're gentle and lowly in heart. And so we give you thanks and we worship you today, Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, let's do it, because it's part of our practice as a church. Let's sing the doxology together. Would you join me? Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen and amen. Hey, we wanted to remind you that on these Lord's Table mornings, these Communion Sundays, this is the week when we take our care offering in our church family. And just as you have been giving online in those three ways that we always tell you about, so we want to invite you to give to our care fund on this particular week. This would be an over and above gift beyond what you give to our ministry fund, really just to help those in need in our church family and those in need in the broader community. And if you give online, you can see that there's a care fund offering option for you there. And so we just wanted to remind you of that on this particular Sunday. Well, I think that's it today. And so wherever you are today, we want to invite you to stand and let's speak God's word to one another. We've been just sticking with this benediction all the way through COVID. We're not quite finished. We see a recovery happening. We're so excited, but we're sticking with this this doxology, this benediction, as we wrap up our service today. And so wherever you are, would you join me? Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. For our heart is glad in Him, because we trust in His holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. Thank you so much for worshiping with us online at Grace Central Coast, and we'll see you next week. Lord bless you.
Hi, kids. I'm Dory, the Kids Ministry Director at Grace Central Coast. Today, we're going to sing some songs, listen to a Bible story video, and hear questions from kids. So let's get started.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Figs.
Figs who?
Figs your doorbell. It's broken. Hey, kids, it's time for sing-along songs. The part of the show where you sing along while we sing a song. And today, I've got a special treat for you.
What's that?
Well, it's a song called the sing-along song.
What?
I know. Your mind's going to be blown.
That's crazy.
All right, it goes like this. This is a song you can sing along. Just make sure you don't get the words wrong. It's super easy, just follow along and sing the words with me. Bureaucratic, Adriatic, cryptocurrency, Annabella, Parabellum, laryngoscopy, ethnogeographical, Michelangelo, intermittent aberration, elongated toe. That was a song that's already half gone. The second part, you just sing along. Just remember your training and fall in line and sing along with me. Maharaja, Sectum, Semper, Macedonia, disambiguation, mycoplasmatacea, countertops, triceratops, megalomaniac, Anchorman, Afghanistan, Habakkuk, Hakmatack.
The Apostle Paul told people the good news about Jesus wherever he went. When he returned to Jerusalem, the believers were glad to see him. But many Jews did not like that Paul taught people they don't have to follow Jewish laws to be saved. So these Jews made a plan to stop Paul. Paul was at the temple when a crowd of people dragged him away and tried to kill him. but a Roman official came and stopped them. The official arrested Paul and brought him to the Sanhedrin, a powerful group of Jewish priests and other leaders. Their job was to decide if a person had broken a Jewish law, and if so, to decide how that person should be punished. Paul stood in front of the Sanhedrin and looked the men in the eyes. "Friends," he said, "I have done what God wants me to do. I do not believe I have done anything wrong." Paul explained that he had been arrested because he taught that Jesus' resurrection gave hope that we all can be resurrected. The men in the Sanhedrin began arguing. Some of them thought dead people would be resurrected at the end of time, and others thought that would not happen. The Roman soldiers took Paul away to keep him safe. The next night, the Lord stood by Paul and gave him an incredible message. "Have courage," he said. "You told about me in Jerusalem. I want you to tell about me in Rome too." In the morning, a group of Jews got together and made a plan to kill Paul. They promised to not eat or drink until Paul was dead. These men told the Jewish leaders about their plan. Paul's nephew overheard this evil plan. He hurried to tell Paul what was going on. Paul told his nephew to report it to the commander. The army commander said, "Don't tell anyone that you told me about this plan." Then the commander told two of his officers to get together a large group of soldiers and horses. They brought a horse for Paul to ride on. And that night, the soldiers took Paul to Caesarea to see the governor. Even when others threatened his life, Paul continued to obey Jesus. He believed that God, who showed his love for the world by sending his son to die on the cross and rise again, would help him through hard times. We too can risk everything to share the gospel with courage because we know that God loves us and will care for us.
Hi there, I'm Pastor Brian, and it's time for Questions from Kids. Jace from West Frankfort, Illinois asks,
why do some people want others to stop sharing good news about Jesus?
Jace, that is a fantastic question. You know, we see this in the Bible story today when some people wanted to stop Paul from telling others about Jesus. We've also seen it earlier. People did the same thing. They tried to keep Peter quiet. Even in the Gospels, people tried to stop Jesus himself from sharing how we can be saved and know God personally. So why? Why did people do it then? Why do people do it now? So at the core here, what I think is going on is that people, when they're confronted by Jesus, it forces them to look within themselves and realize that they are not following him. They've not trusted in him. And that really makes them uncomfortable. And I think when they're confronted with the truth, and God is true, and they're confronted with that truth, the way they defend themselves because they're not ready to follow Jesus is they push back against him. And so it's really a defense mechanism on a lot of people's thought. I think that is really at the core of what is going on here. And so when people push back and they try to keep us quiet from telling others about Jesus, I don't think we should see them as enemies, as hostile toward us. I think we should see them with sympathy, with compassion, with love, because they're missing it. They're missing the truth. They've not trusted in Jesus, and they desperately need to hear about God and about how they can be saved through Jesus so they can come to know him. So to me, I think when we respond in situations like this, it should be through that, with compassion and with a heart to care about that person who's trying to keep us quiet. So here's a question back for you. How could you respond to someone who doesn't want to hear what you have to say about Jesus?
Hey kids, I'm so glad you hung out with us this week. We sure had fun. We're going to close with our favorite song, Proverbs 3, 5 to 6. And what style should we use today for it? Jazz? Metal?
No, I hate both of those.
Polka?
No.
What do you have in mind?
I was thinking, and you could tell me if this is not a good idea, but I was thinking we sing like surfer dudes, you know what?
I love come that on, genre.
Bro. Yeah.
The music. Yeah, let's sail like surfer
dudes. All right.
I got it.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path.
We're so glad you joined us today. Again, I'm Dory, the Kids Ministry Director at the SLO Campus. Our kids ministry team at Grace Central Coast is committed to helping your kids find and follow Jesus and committed to helping you disciple your kids. For further resources or to contact us, go to gracecentralcoast.org. Have a great day.